Good morning, good morning. Welcome to The Rocks. This is just a friendly reminder that in a few short minutes we'll be starting our 11 o'clock gathering in our main auditorium. Thank you for all of you sitting here ready, just having a nice quiet time before we start. If you're out in the main foyer or if you're organising a coffee, please continue to do so, but we'll see you in the auditorium in a few short minutes to start our 11 o'clock. Thanks for coming along.
Welcome to The Rocks, a place where no perfect people are allowed. A place where you don't need to have your life together before you can come here. Because let's be honest, who does? It doesn't matter where you've come from or where you are now, we're just glad you're here. In fact, we believe that this is a place where you can belong before you believe. We want to create a culture of grace and authenticity where we can be honest about our imperfections. An environment where we can find the support and help we need to become whole. We want to band together to fight the darkness, to be the church that Jesus has called us to be. We believe that Jesus is not repelled by our fault, and even in our messiness, he still loves us and calls us to greater things. We want to extend that same love we have received from Jesus to others. For far too long, the church has been known for what it's against. We want to be known for what we are for. We are for everyone.
Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to The Rocks. My name is Peter Chasen. I get the pleasure of welcoming you in and just being a host for a few minutes today. Thanks for coming along. Our first week after Easter. I hope everyone's had a great Easter time. And last week was your first time, because we had so many visitors last week, and you've chosen to come back again this week, we're so glad that you have, and we would love to welcome you in. Now, we have a new guest lounge for anybody who's new in The Rocks. We love to try and make coming into a big community like this a little bit easier, because it's sometimes hard. So we've got a new guest lounge out in this main foyer. Up against the back window, there's a space where we've got volunteers that just want to make your first visit to The Rocks. Now, because Easter was so crazy, we had lots of people. If this is your second week, we'd still call you a new person, a new guest. So if this is your second week and you didn't get to the new guest lounge, please go there anyway and just say, hi, I'm new here, because there is a free barista coffee for newcomers and there's a small gift, and we love to just welcome you. So that's for us today, and we're so glad that you've come. Now, we're going to be together for about an hour today. The words for some songs are going to be up on the screen, and some voices are going to come and join this band that's got such a groove. I love just sort of being in their groove today. So I'm going to invite you up on your feet as you just get that groove going. Please jump up, just get the groove going, and let's enjoy some song and worship together. It's a great time to be together.
Good morning, everyone. We're so glad that you made it out here this morning. We're going to sing a few songs together about God's promise that is always good for us, and He's true to His word. So let's continue to sing together and learn that we put our trust in Him always.
know when PD shared about the denial and restoration of Peter, you know, actually Jesus already saw Peter at his worst. He already saw Peter's denial, and he has a plan of restoring him. Yeah. You know, in Luke 22, he actually said this to Peter, "I've prayed for you, Peter, that your faith may not fail. And when you turn back to me, you know, support your brothers." And that is actually already the restoration story. He said it before he went to the cross. And after the cross, he went to Peter intimately to restore him. So today, whatever you're feeling that you're a failure, or you're feeling you've made many mistakes, God already has a restoration plan for you. He's going to restore you. He's going to love you back to wholeness. This is the God that we love. This is the God that we sing and we trust. So as we sing, let us know this truth in our hearts. Amen.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. He's been my fourth man in the fire, time after time. Born of his spirit, washed in his blood, and what he did for trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. put our trust in you this morning. We want to speak your name over our life, over our struggle, over the chain that brings us down. We want to declare there is freedom and there is hope.
Presence, I speak Jesus.
Lord. Oh, Lord, we just want to sit and enjoy you, Lord. We want to enjoy that name of Jesus. And it's not just a name. It's just not a magical word. It's your character, Lord, the word that represents you, your personality, your attitude, your character, and your power. And we want to speak that name, Jesus, that word. Jesus, your character came into this earth, Lord, and you not only spoke words that changed the whole of human mindset, Lord. Lord, words to this very day, Lord, across the world is recognized as the way a human should live, Lord, a way humans are made to live, Lord. Not only did you speak those words, but you headed towards the cross, Lord. You spoke of your sacrifice. You spoke of the journey. You spoke of it all the way, Lord, up onto the cross, and your life was given up, Lord, for us. But not only that, you arose again. Jesus, you came back, and so your words, Lord, did not die with you. Your words didn't pass away. Your words are back to life. Lord, those words mean something. Lord, they mean something today. Lord, in the hearts of every person, Lord, in this little room, in this little church, Lord, your words mean life. And Lord, I pray that you are become, you're the center of this gathering. You're the center of every heart in the room. You're the center of every heart that's watching online. Lord, I pray that, Lord, we put the name of Jesus in the middle of our lives, Lord. We want you to be the one who's known here. Lord, we celebrate you, we worship you, and we enjoy you. Father God, thank you for your Son, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Oh, and that's why we pray all these things in the name of Jesus. And say together with me, amen. Let's give the Lord a hand. Hallelujah, Lord. Thank you. That is so amazing. Oh, man. Thank you guys for leading us in worship. I'm going to invite you to grab your seats. We're so grateful for these talented musicians and singers. Thank you. In the darkness, watch where you're sitting. Can become very friendly. Hi, my name is Peter Chase. How good is that to come and gather and sing? I get reminded every time I'm in a place like this and worshiping together of what my life was without him, and I can't get over what God has done in my life. And so I just want to welcome you into the Rocks today. We have a saying, no perfect people allowed. It applies to me very much, and I know it. I think I'm being a bit bold here, but it probably applies to every human life in the room, because we recognize that Jesus is the one. And over this last couple of weeks, we've had Palm Sunday, we've gathered for Palm Sunday, we gathered for Good Friday, we gathered for Easter Sunday. Many of you came and gathered, and we thank you. If you were a first-time visitor last week and you've come back today, we want to say thank you for coming back and being with us. But as I was preparing for this, I just wanted to mention that we are a faith community, and it's so good to come together as a community, because I think it's what the human heart longs for, is to be part of something. And we're on a faith journey together, every single one of us in this room. And this is your second week here, or it's your first week here, we're so grateful to come and have part of your journey with us. And if you've been here for 14 years or more, we're on a journey together, and we are a faith community together. It's so good. Now, if you are new, I mentioned earlier on, but we have a new guest lounge out in the main foyer. It's a place, if you're new here and you've been invited by somebody, a friend of yours has brought you, they're a good friend, they've brought you to become part of this community, please head out to the guest lounge. Just say, I'm new here. Now, there's a few things happening. This is a little bit at the middle of our gathering after our worship, where I just let you know a bit of what's happening around the Rocks. There's so much that happens. All of our young people are away on a camp, finishing up the camp today. If you've got young people away, it's such a great to know that our young generation, the next generation, which in a very few years is going to be the leaders of our churches, and we're so good that they're away gathering. We're also going to have another gathering next Sunday afternoon at 5 o'clock. It's a worship time. We're going to get together just to come together and worship with one another at 5 o'clock next Sunday. And it's, you know, if those three songs that we just had, we have to sort of keep it short because we have a timetable every Sunday. But if you would love to just be in that space a little bit longer and be together again as a faith community, please come next Sunday and just come and enjoy what a community is, putting Jesus in the center. It's such a great thing. I want to also mention, you are a very generous church, and it's such an indicator of the work of God in our lives as we start holding all of the worldly stuff a little less, and we start letting, we know that there's a bigger thing and a bigger thing going on. God's kingdom is at work in the earth. And so many of you are generous with your earthly possessions and you give regularly to the Rocks. And we say thank you for that. If you're a visitor today where this isn't a money grab, we love that you're visiting and we love that you've just come to be part of what has been created by all of the regular givers here at the Rocks. Now, I want to mention the ways to give, always up on the screen there. You can find the ways to give on our rocks.info, and there are some drop boxes at the back of the room. But our giving, last year, I don't know if many of you, if you've been here from a little bit of last year, we mentioned about our campus that's in Baldivis. There's a building down there, a group that about the Rocks in Baldivis. They've had a building that's been part of a community in Baldivis before it exploded into a huge suburb. And that building needed some work, and many of you jumped on board and pledged, given the money to give to help that building come back to a place where a community of faith can gather regularly. So we would love to just remind you that there is a For Baldivis campaign that's continual and running, but to give you some encouragement, Pastor Alistair is from our lead pastor down in Baldivis, wants to show you a little bit about it and tell you a little bit about it. So just have a little look and see what's happening and has happened in Baldivis.
We just want to take a moment to say thank you so much to everyone who has given to For Baldivis. There have been over 180 contributors to build this incredible space. And I just want to say from the bottom of our hearts how grateful we are. When we set out to build this project, one of the key things that we try to remind ourselves was that we are not investing in bricks and mortar. We're actually investing in people. And I'm here today to tell you that that has become a reality. We have seen so much more engagement, not only from the community around us, but from even the community within us. People are using this space on a Sunday to connect. And we really believe as a church that those of us that are connected relationally are more likely to grow spiritually. And so I just want to say thank you so much to everyone who has given to For Baldivis, because that giving has directly impacted the community that we're building. And I just want to say thank you because I'm so excited for this next season that God is calling us into as a church.
Yeah, how good is that? So Alistair has just let us know and shown us around a little bit. I just wanted to say thank you for many of you who have been pledged and have been continually faithfully giving to the tab that's on the rocks.info, the For Baldivis tab, and just being able to give into that space. As you know, with a building that's finished, the paying of it is constant and ongoing. And we just, again, like to remind people, if you're a regular giver here and you're at your giving max, and that's fine, we just say, please just continue to give, and you don't have to add anything more or put anything more on. But if God blesses you with something, or if you have it on your heart to just continue to contribute to just making that space, I love how Alistair just mentioned when a community is relationally together, people can grow together in that faith journey, which I love. Now, it's almost all from me, but I want to let you know if you have it is your first week or it's your second week here at the Rocks, you've come on a great week, because we're about to start a new series looking at faith, and there's an intriguing title called Toxic Faith. Now, it sounds negative, but it's actually all aimed at being a positive thing for our lives to truly reflect the work of Jesus in our lives. So I'm not going to say any more, but Pastor Daniel is going to come and deliver the first one of these series. So please be ready for God to really speak to you. Be open. Just be receiving of what God wants to say, because sometimes he likes to correct and journey with us. So there's a little bit of reading I'd love you to do. So as you sit and wait for Pastor Daniel, just follow along and read what the scripture is that's put up on the screen behind me. So thank you for being here with us. Thank you.
Some time ago, I read a book by Stephen Otterburn that inspires this new series. The book started with a quote from an article, and I want to read to you the article word for word. Of all the things that can be said about Wesley Parker's death at the age of 11, the saddest is this: his parents let it happen. Burning with religious zeal, Larry and Lucky Parker watched their eldest of the four children succumb to diabetic shock while they clutched their Bibles and withheld the insulin that he needed. In the past 15 years, at least 126 children in the United States have died because their parents withheld the medical treatment out of doctrinal conviction that prayer is the only needed treatment for illness. I think I don't have to elaborate anymore that this kind of faith is toxic and very, very dangerous. That's why we're starting this brand new series today that we call Toxic Faith. Maybe your faith, maybe you think that your faith is not that dangerous. Maybe you think your faith is okay. But in this series, we're going to talk about how we can find out how healthy or how toxic our faith is. Maybe you believe if you give $1,000 to God, God will give $10,000 back to you, and that's why you keep giving to God. Maybe you have other faith or belief that is actually not faith in the first place. Maybe you're here and you're not a Christian, and the reason why you're not a Christian or you don't go to church is because this is the kind of Christianity that you've been exposed to. And if that's the case, I want to apologize, because that is not Christianity, that is not Jesus. So in this series, we're going to be a student and not a critic, all right? I know, because some of you come from a different faith background, maybe you've held to this long-held belief or faith that is actually toxic and you don't even realize it. I'm going to poke something that may cause you to be angry and to be upset with me, but that's not my purpose of doing this series. My purpose is for all of us to come together, like Peter said, as a faith community, as a student, as a learner, how we can continue to follow Jesus better and better in our lives, because we believe following Him will make our lives better and will make us better at life. Yeah? So I want to start with a definition first. Okay, here's how I would define toxic faith. It is a distorted belief system that strays from the Bible's core teachings of love, truth, and grace, often leading to harmful behaviors such as legalism, judgmental attitudes, and spiritual abuse, and many other bad or unhealthy behaviors. The key word here is distorted, all right? That means it's twisted. That means it's altered from the original form. This is not the kind of faith that Jesus wanted you to have. This is counterfeit faith, all right? It is precisely what Jesus wants you to avoid. So the question is, how do we develop this kind of toxic faith? How do people even have this faith, all right? I believe, this is just my opinion, I believe all of us are actually susceptible to having this kind of toxic faith, right? But at the same time, unfortunately, there are people who are more prone to have this kind of faith than others. For example, if you grew up in a rigid home, if you belong to a legalistic church, maybe you have more of a tendency to develop this toxic faith. Maybe you don't see God as the kind and good and loving Father that He is. Your relationship with God is all transactional. You see Him as this authoritative figure that needs to be obeyed, otherwise you'll be in trouble. And that kind of faith is actually toxic and you don't even realize it. You think that's actually what God wants, right? And strangely, these people who grew up in this rigid home, they are drawn to legalistic churches, right? I guess it's correct what people say, hurt people hurt people, abused people abuse other people, bullied people bully others. So when you grew up in a toxic environment that is where everything is legalistic, where you have to work hard to earn your parental love, right? Your parents' love. You have the tendency to find this kind of community to belong to. Or, how about this? If you experience some kind of disappointment in your life, you have a tendency to develop a toxic faith. I mean, life is tough, right? We talk about divorce. We talk about death in a family, people that we love. We talk about bankruptcy, business failure, relationship failure. Life is tough. And if you're going through such a period in your life right now, my prayer is for you. And I believe that there's a way out for you, okay? But I can't even begin to imagine what some people have to go through in life. But unfortunately, having this kind of experience can also cause you to have a toxic faith. Maybe you lost a child, for example, a mother who lost her child, expects a loving God would rescue her child, would protect her child from harm, from danger. So when God doesn't do what she wanted God to do, you know, you can lose your faith in God, or you can have a relationship with God that is not healthy. How about childhood trauma? You grew up in a home where there was a lot of abuse. Maybe your parents got divorced and you felt guilty about it. You felt somehow it was your fault that your parents got divorced. So when you approach God with faith, you know, you approach a God that needs to be obeyed, and a God that you need to work hard to earn that favor, that love from God. Because you believe the reason why your parents got divorced is because, you know, you don't behave enough as a child. I don't know. But all these reasons can really cause you to develop that kind of faith. But maybe the number one reason is this. When you have weak foundation of your faith to begin with, you are very susceptible to have toxic faith. The Apostle Paul actually talked about this. He said, you know, a lot of Christians are easily tossed back and forth by the waves. You know, you get blown here and there by the winds of different teaching out there, and you just believe whatever you hear, and that's because you don't have a solid faith to begin with. This is why some of you have more propensity to develop this kind of faith. So now that we know, all right, who are the people who are more prone to have this kind of faith? Maybe that helps you, maybe it doesn't. But the question that you all want to know, that I want to know, is this. How does this toxic faith manifest itself? How do we know, right? How do I know if my faith is healthy or my faith is toxic? Well, I think there are a few pointers for you to look at. Could be this. If you are self-obsessed with yourself, right? This is when your constant focus is on your life, on your hurts, on your desire for relief, on your needs, then there's a possibility that your faith might be toxic. So you don't have time to serve others. You don't have time to serve God. You see God as a place or as a person where your pressure of life can get released, all right? Now, there's nothing wrong with approaching God that way, all right? There's nothing wrong with crying out to God for help. I think God is there to listen to you. But if every focus of your life, okay, if every little detail of your life is what you care about, everything revolves around you, there is a strong possibility that you have toxic faith, all right? You just concentrate on how your needs can be met instead of how you can focus on others and meet the need of others. How about this? Toxic faith can look like being addicted to religious high. Coming to a place like this, singing. I mean, I was there standing, singing the songs. It was a wonderful experience, right? And I believe God can speak to you through words. God can speak to you through songs. It is powerful. We have a worship night next week. That means you come in the morning. We're not canceling the morning gatherings, by the way. But if you want to come at night and have an extended time of worship, it's a wonderful time where the Holy Spirit can minister to your need and all that. And He does all that. I'm not against that. I mean, we want to foster that in this church. But here's what I'm saying. If you think that faith or spirituality it's all about having that religious experience. Maybe you use phrases like, oh, God is present in this place, the atmosphere is thick here and all that, which is fantastic. But if that's all you're looking for, man, I believe your faith is not as healthy as it could be. You see, it's wonderful to go to events, but usually the way God works is He develops your faith through process, right? Going to events, fantastic. But it is in the day-to-day where your faith will grow. It is in the hard yard, it is in the trenches that your faith grows. That's why Jesus said, if you come to God to worship and you bring an offering, and then you have something against your brother, what do you need to do? You got to fix that broken relationship with your brother and then come back and worship God. But we don't like to deal with that, right? We don't like to mend our broken relationship with our husband, with our wife. We don't like to forgive, to get rid of anger. We don't like all that because that's not spiritual. It's like too normal, too human. I want this mountaintop experience with God. That is faith. That is spiritual. If you think that, I'm afraid to say that maybe your faith is not as healthy as you think. Right? I can, with light and smoke and different chords, you can make anybody cry, right? How do you know it's the Holy Spirit? How do you know it's God? Go watch Korean dramas and you will cry. Right? So what I'm saying is, yes, God can work through all that, but you would be wrong to believe that spirituality or faith equals religious experience. Okay? God can work through that, but that is not religious experience. How about this? Sometimes toxic faith can look like laziness. It's rough, I know. But I'm going to, like a doctor, pointing at your, different parts of your body that causes pain. Maybe this is you. Maybe you use terms like, I'm just going to let go and let God. I'm just going to be waiting on God. I'm trying to work out a balance between life, work, and ministry here. Well, sorry to say, you're just lazy. All right? You play 3 hours of computer games every night, and then you don't have time to serve. And I'm afraid that is just laziness masquerading in the form of faith. That's why that kind of faith is toxic. Remember Jesus' parable about a master who gave 5 talents, 2 talents, and 1 talent to his servants and ask them to work it, right? And then he comes back to demand accountability from them. That's exactly what God will do with us, Salvation is free. It's all by God's grace. But what we do with our lives, what we do with our time, what we do with our money, at one point, God is going to demand accountability from us. So if you have been sitting on the sidelines, all right, of life, expecting God to do everything for you while you sit back, relax, and enjoy, you have a skewed and distorted view of faith, all right? That is not a healthy faith. And then finally, sometimes toxic faith looks like extreme intolerance. If you don't believe what I believe, that means you're not my brother. You're not my sister. That means you're wrong. So you're very black and white in your belief. If you believe in infant baptism, you're an idiot. If you don't believe in infant baptism, you're an idiot. If you think church should be done this way, you're an idiot. If you think church shouldn't be done this way, you're an idiot. Everyone's an idiot except you. All right? Now, if you start using this phrase like, oh, you don't use the term idiot maybe, but you start disagreeing with people here, disagreeing with people there, even if they're Christians expressing their faith in a slightly different way, but everyone is wrong except you, your view of life is the only correct one, you might be in danger of having toxic faith, all right? Maybe you are more committed to your perception of truth than you are committed to Jesus himself, especially when your conviction of truth trumps the need of you to love other people, all right? That is a telltale sign of you having a toxic faith. So, with the rest of the time that we have, today, next week, maybe even the following week, we're going to talk about some of the toxic beliefs of toxic faith, all right? There are many of them. We can go and do this series for until the end of the year. I look at like, oh man, this is not the right belief. This is not the right belief. We can talk about it for years even. But we're just going to take some time for the next few weeks to talk about some of these toxic beliefs of toxic faith. First one is this: instant peace. Many Christians believe that when tragedy strikes, true believers should have a real peace about it and have it instantaneously. My dad died almost 2 years ago, the day after Father's Day. He was just at my house having dinner on Father's Day, and then the next morning, after his morning walk, he just died on the sofa. I received hundreds of messages, literally, voicemails, messages, WhatsApp, and I can categorize all those messages that I receive into three different categories. One, I should be grateful that my dad died quickly, that he was not suffering much pain. Two, I should be grateful that my dad had lived a long life. He was 82 when he died. And I should be grateful that my dad is now with Jesus. You know what I wanted to do to those people? I want to strangle them. I'm a pastor, right? I know it's better for you to die quickly than to suffer through years of struggle, right? I know 82 years is like, that's a decent length of life. I know that my dad is with Jesus. But would you let me grieve? Would you let me process this feeling of loss and hurt and pain? Do I have to have peace right away? Do I have to be grateful to God right away? I am grateful to God, but do you need to point that out to me? Do you need to preach to me about having peace while I'm grieving? I don't think that's appropriate. I don't think that's helpful, all right? Do you remember when Jesus' friend Lazarus died, Mary and Martha came to Jesus, right? And they said, Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother wouldn't have died. Now, Jesus knew that he was going to raise Lazarus back from the dead. Did he say to the two sisters, hey, girls, don't worry, don't cry. I'm going to raise him back to life again. Don't worry about it. Jesus didn't say that. You know what he did? He just cried with them. He just cried with them. Why did he cry with them, knowing that he's going to raise Lazarus back to life? Because Jesus knew what it's like to mourn. Jesus knew what it's like to lose someone. Jesus knew what Martha and Mary were feeling at the time. And empathizing with them is more important at the time than preaching the truth of God's word, right? I mean, there will be a time that is appropriate for you to share a verse maybe later down the line. But at that time, you see, peace does not need to be instantaneous. This is what Jesus says in the Sermon on the Mount. Blessed are those who mourn. Blessed are those who mourn. Not because it is good to mourn, it's terrible to mourn, right? I mean, I firsthand experienced how terrible it is to mourn. But blessed are those who mourn, not because they mourn, but because they will be comforted. The reason why they're blessed is in the second half of the sentence. You see, when you mourn, you're not going to be mourning alone. God is right there. The Holy Spirit is right there by your side. He will allow you that time to mourn, to process, but then His comfort will be there for you. See, even in this sentence, it's like built in the freedom for you to mourn. Jesus didn't say, it is a sin to mourn. No, Jesus didn't say, it is a sin to mourn. You are blessed when you mourn because you will receive comfort. So that means it's okay for you to process your feelings. All right? You see, this desire for instant peace in the midst of tragedy often leads people to denial, to unresolved emotions, and a complete split from reality. And that is not healthy. All right? Yes, true believers will find peace that passes all understanding in God. I guarantee you that. I experienced that firsthand myself, right? True believers will find peace, but God does allow natural emotion emotional process such as anger, pain, disappointment, you know, bitterness even, to be a part of your healing process. Listen to what the psalmist says in Psalm 22. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me, so far from my cries of anguish? My God, I cry out by day, but you do not answer. By night, but I find no rest. And Jesus quoted from this psalm from the cross. My God, why have you forsaken me? See, even Jesus needed to process all that emotion of being abandoned by his heavenly Father. It was difficult for Jesus because he was never, ever in the history of humanity, in the history of time, he's never been separated from his heavenly Father. But at that brief moment at the cross, in order to save humanity, God looked his face away from Jesus, turned his face away from Jesus, and that's why Jesus cried in anguish, "Why have you forsaken me, Father?" There's no voice from heaven saying, "Don't worry about it, my son. I'm going to rescue you." God the Father allowed Jesus to experience that emotion, even though he knew he's going to be raised back from the dead. Let me give you another one. Psalm 44. "Awake, Lord, why do you sleep? Rouse yourself. Do not reject us forever. Why do you hide your face and forget our misery and oppression?" You see, all these different verses, different psalms, different prayers in the Bible mean that it is okay. It is acceptable for you for a moment to be expressive in your feelings, right? You don't have to hide from God. God knows exactly how you feel. You might as well be truthful, right? So lack of peace does not mean lack of faith. People in pain, especially people in extreme pain, do need the peace that comes from God. And God, let me tell you, the peace that passes understanding is available for you. But just know that it's okay for you to process your pain together with God. All right? So that's the first one. Number two, this is another toxic belief of toxic faith. Guaranteed healing. If I have real faith, God will heal me or someone that I'm praying for. Now, I got to warn you, some of you come from a church background that believe in healing and all that, right? You believe that if you follow Jesus, you will be wealthy and you'll be healthy. We call it the health and wealth gospel. I'm not here to mock your faith. I'm not here to mock your belief. Like I said, we all come here to learn, all right? It's okay for us to have different opinion on this. That's why in this church, our slogan is "No perfect people allowed." So I hope you're not going to be offended by me when I say this. I believe God can heal. I believe God still heals today. I believe God can do miracles. My wife and I are the proof that God can still do miracles, right? Hulda and I, medically, it is impossible for us to have children. It is just medically impossible. We tried. We went to the fertility clinic, all right? So, but what is impossible with men is very possible with God. How many of you know that, right? But having said that, I think it's naive, I think it's unhealthy, I think it's toxic for you to believe that every single time you're sick, you will definitely be healed in this world, at least. I believe you'll be healed, if not in this world, in the world to come. But for you to believe that there is instant peace, instant health and all that, that is not biblical. All right, let me prove it to you. This is what Paul wrote to his protege, Timothy, who was pastoring a church in Ephesus. Paul says this, "Stop drinking only water." I can imagine just he's saying it with a fatherly tone. "Stop drinking only water and use a little wine because of your stomach and your frequent illnesses." That means Timothy was sickly. His body was not the healthiest. It wasn't the best. See, Paul didn't just lay hand on Timothy and said, "Timothy, be healed. From now on, you'll be as strong as Samson." No. Like, hey, my advice to you is not to pray and get deliverance from God. My advice to you is to drink a little bit of wine because your body is sickly. There's a verse for you, for those of you who want to drink wine, right? But the key word is little. Little. This much. 10 mil, 2 bottles, it's not for health, right? Don't say, I'm gonna drink these 2 bottles for health reason. No, a little wine is okay, right? So this verse proves that, hey, being sick is a part of life, unfortunately. It's not God's original intent because this is a sinful world where sickness, you know, unfairness, injustice, everything happens in this world. But God is going to redeem this. He already started the process of redemption 2,000 years ago, but he's going to come back again the second time where he himself is going to wipe away all the tears from your eyes. No more sickness, no more cancer, no more pain, no more wheelchair, nothing. But that's in the future. So we live in the already but not yet world right now, right? Already, you can receive miracle. Already there is healing, but the full manifestation of it is not going to be realized until Jesus comes for a second time. You know, for every healing testimony that I heard, I can name you 100 other testimonies of people who, despite their love for Jesus, despite their faith, they don't get the healing that they wanted, right? What do you say to them? They don't have enough faith? God doesn't care about them? Of course you can't say that, right? But here's what Jesus' promise is. No matter who you are, no matter how bad the suffering that you go through, Jesus promised that His grace will be enough for you. His grace will be sufficient for you. That's what Paul says. You know, he also prayed 3 times for God to remove the thorns in his flesh. It says 3 times, I pleaded with the Lord to take it away from me. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in your weakness. And that with this understanding, Paul says, therefore means in conclusion. Ah, now I know, Paul says. Even though I'm weak, but his strength is enough for me. His grace is enough for me. His power is made perfect in my weakness. So I will be more than glad to boast in my weaknesses so that Christ's power may rest on me. In other words, Paul is saying, I would rather be weak but with Jesus and His power than be strong but without His presence and without His power in my life. All right? So that's number 2. By all means, we believe in miracles in this church. We believe in healing. We believe in prayer. Do all that. Express your desire to God. But leave the result to God. All right? Which brings me to the last toxic belief of toxic faith that I want to talk about today because of the time that we had. Bulletproof faith. A strong faith will give me anything that I want if I believe it. Right? How do we develop this kind of toxic belief? From culture, that's number 1. From different songs, I believe I can fly. There can be miracles if you believe. That's right, right? So we learn that from songs, not from the Bible. But you do learn that from a misinterpretation of the Bible. Because this is what Jesus said. Truly, I'll tell you, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move. Nothing will be impossible for you. There you have it. Daniel, that's why if you believe, anything can happen. You can have whatever you want if you believe. Even if your faith is as small as a mustard seed, that's not what Jesus is trying to say. This is how this kind of toxic faith expresses itself in reality, right? This is toxic. When your faith depends on what God does, so this is what you're saying to God. Maybe you don't realize this. God, if you do what I like, if you can perform, if you can fulfill my desire, then I will continue to believe in you. I will continue to trust you. I will keep my faith in you. But my faith depends on what you do for me. So you better do what I want if you want me to keep believing in you. And so many Christians have this kind of faith. Right? They do good, they do right, but the moment God doesn't answer their prayer, the moment God does something that they don't like, they leave God altogether. This is toxic. The second expression of this toxic faith is the opposite. So this one says, what God does depends on my faith. Okay? So you start with the desire first. I want to be healthy. I want my business to be successful. Oh, if I want that, then I better have faith. Because if I have faith, God will give me what I want, which is a successful business, a healthy body, and whatever you're praying for. Now, number 1 and number 2 look different, but they're actually the same, right? At the end of the day, number 1 says, God, if you do what I want, I keep believing. Number 2 says, hey, if I have faith, God will do what I want. So at the end of the day, it's all about what you want. It's not about what God wants. It's not about you having faith in God. It's more about you having faith in you and what you want and having faith in faith, maybe. That is not true faith. That faith is so toxic because faith does not depend on the outcome. Faith depends on the object of your faith. Final example. This is a powerful example. If you're familiar with the story of Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, the 4 friends, 4 Jewish boys who were taken captive to Babylon, right? So at one point, Daniel's 3 friends, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, were brought before the king, Nebuchadnezzar, because there was an edict being issued that everyone must worship the king. Because the king, in those days, they believed themselves as God. They must worship the king. Otherwise, they'll be thrown into the fiery furnace. We sang about it in one of our songs. And Daniel's three friends refused to worship the king. And this is what they said. They said, "We believe, we have faith that God can rescue us from the fiery furnace." Right? That's good. But the powerful part of their statement is this. We believe God can rescue us from the fiery furnace. But then they said this. But even if he doesn't, even if he doesn't, we're not going to worship you, O king. We're going to worship the one true living God still. So what they're saying is, we believe God can do this, but even if he doesn't do what we want, we're going to still believe in this God. Again, like Peter said, because of his character, because he's proven himself over and over again to be good to us. That's why we're not going to worship you, king. We're going to worship this one true living God, because faith does not depend on the outcome. Faith depends on the object of your faith, right? Jesus, time and time again, has proven himself faithful, gracious, kind, loving to you. You can trust this Jesus, all right? So here's how I would summarize what Jesus is trying to say. Yes, by all means, try to develop your faith. Big faith is when you believe that you can move mountains. It's good to have that kind of faith. But mature faith is this, when you still believe God, even if the mountain doesn't move. You still believe God anyway. Wow. I wish every single one of you, including me, will have that kind of faith. That kind of trust in God, that no matter what, God, even we believe you can move mountains, but even if they don't move, we're still gonna trust you. So for the rest of our time together in the next few weeks, we're gonna do this series for 3 or 4 weeks, right? I want to give you some handle how you can start processing this. And we're going to keep showing this to you over the next few weeks. The handles are these. Number one, start reflecting and understanding on what you actually believe. All right? That's the first step. Number two, reorient yourself. Read, learn about what a healthy belief actually is. We're going to talk about this. Number three, reevaluate. What adjustment do I need to make based on this new discovery that I have? And number four, recommit. Put it into practice. Try slowly, one by one, step by step, little by little. Recommit, put it into practice. And then finally, number five, reconnect. Be vulnerable with the people around you and confess those toxic beliefs and what you've learned about yourself in the process. So we have this QR code that you can scan. It's going to be at rocks.info, I believe, as well. And then start in your own private time with God, in your small group. Start processing some of this, and then I believe it is God's desire, God's plan, for your faith to get healthier and healthier and healthier, for you to become more and more mature in your relationship with God, so you don't get tossed back and forth by every winds of teaching, by every wave, right? But your faith is the faith that not only will be good for you, it'll be good for your family, it'll be good for the people that you deal with around you, because God's desire, it's not just to bless you. He desires to bless the people that are in your world, right? Not self-obsessed with everything that's going on in your life, but start thinking about the others as well. And you can only do that if you have healthy faith. Why don't you stand up from your seat, and we're going to close our time together. Keep coming back. Invite your friends to come as we process this together as a faith family here. Hey, it is our custom to be dismissed by receiving a prayer of blessing. If you're comfortable, you have the faith to receive it, why don't you open your hands as a sign of our dependence on God. Father, thank you for reminding us of what toxic faith is and what healthy faith could be. Thank you, Jesus, for showing us the way. Thank you for your grace that is enough for all of us. Thank you for your patience, that despite our wrong beliefs, you're still there for us. You still care about us, and you still want the best for us. So we pray, Lord, as we speak about this for the next few weeks, I pray that you continue to process us, continue to speak to us, Lord, in our own private moments, in our family, in this faith community. Help us to talk about this more and more, so that, your will, your desire for our lives will become reality. Thank you so much, Lord. Dismiss us with your blessings, we pray. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, our Heavenly Father, and the fellowship, the power, and the anointing of the Holy Spirit be with you wherever you go. May God bless you through and through. May God bless your family, your work, your health, your finance, your relationships, so that the people around you will be blessed and God's name will be glorified now and forevermore. Everyone who's blessed, sit together with me. Amen. God bless you, everybody. Have a wonderful Sunday. God bless.